just so much as you.
Good noon to you on this very last day of February. I'm Ellen O'Shaughnessy, coordinator of Conversations and Coffee, and celebrating the birth, the 15th birthday of my granddaughter, who was born this very day, February 28th, and with bated breath, we said, Danielle, hurry up. We don't want you to be a leap year baby. And so I just texted her this morning, and she said, yay, Danny, yay. And so as we come together, we celebrate Renaissance, new birth. What a gift. Bettye Stull has been to us in the spirit of new birth and Renaissance. Harlem Renaissance. Very meaningful for me because I worked in Harlem for 6 years. And whenever I see Harlem, oh, the people, the place, what a joy in my life. And I know you continue to celebrate this joy, Bettye. We are so grateful, you as curator. Now, curator is something Bettye knows about. She spent her life curating, facilitating. Even though as an artist she was continually making jewelry, she was always making possible the art for others. And that included the 30 years she worked for Recreation and Parks and worked with children, with facilitating other people's masterpieces. And we continue that spirit today. The masterpieces of Taou's, Murphy's work that we have with us, and the artists whose work surround us. Bettye says, I too sing America in the spirit of Renaissance, new birth. So we thank you, Bettye, and we want to hear from you what this means to you. You have known Taou since he was born and facilitated his life through his father who taught. Your father taught, huh? In a facility, Reckon Parks facility. It's, what is it, painting?
Yes.
Oh, I wonder if that. And so Taou wants to continue that. Tell us more, Bettye, how you know Taou.
Well, I think you have...
Right into that microphone, right?
I think you have given a very nice introduction. First of all, I want to thank Todd and Jeff for inviting me to facilitate this exhibition. During the time when I was facilitating the exhibition, I was ill. And so it started off, I too sing America. And then as we went into Black History Month, we're celebrating the I too sing America for Black History Month. But let me say that during the period of the Harlem Renaissance, it was a time when African-American artists, when African-Americans celebrated Harlem, and they celebrated art. Because at that time, African-American art was not considered something that everyone appreciated. And so it was a time when everybody came together, the musicians, the writers, the visual artists, the artist named Langston Hughes who coined "I Too Sing America." And I just want to just say something about the poem that he wrote. "I too sing America, I'm the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen. When company comes, but I laugh, and I eat well, and grow strong. Tomorrow, I will be at the table when the company comes. Nobody dare say to me, eat in the kitchen. Besides, they see how beautiful I am, and be ashamed, I too am America." Langston Hughes, 1902 to 1967. So Columbus has had an explosion of African-American history and culture during the year of 2018. So we've seen all kinds of programs that have evolved around the Harlem Renaissance. And thanks to the three entities that put this together, it was Larry James who felt that we should celebrate the Harlem Renaissance, the Columbus Museum of Art, Greater Columbus Arts Council, and a young man that coined everything named Yogi Terrell. And he did an excellent marketing job of putting this throughout the city of Columbus. For the first time, African Americans showed their work in the Short North, and eight of the galleries there, they were had work on the walls of I believe five buildings. And so once again, or I should say for the first time, that the works were shown throughout the city. And little did a number of people realize the kind of art that we have. This is just one of, or perhaps the last of, the "I Too Sing America" exhibitions. I also curated an exhibition that is now at the Ross Museum in Delaware. And if you haven't seen that exhibition, I ask you to go there because it's a very, very fine exhibition. And it's titled "Yesterday, Today, Tomorrow," which sort of sums up what we have had in a way of a renaissance here in Columbus. That exhibition, "Yesterday," is of artists who are deceased, or the artists who came before: Elijah Pierce, Amina Robinson, some of the well-known artists that we have. But we also have tomorrow's artists who are the city beside me that's coming along and certainly making a wave in this city in terms of the fine art that they are showing. So with that said, I would like to kind of turn it over to Marianne, or should I turn it over to Tally, so that we can have a conversation.
Clients happen. Nowadays, I don't like myself happy. say, kind of retired, hospital down here, the court system, trying to help expel the other man, you know, have a fighting chance, and he'll come back and finish their education. He instilled a lot of it in myself as far as, you know, confidence and what you want to do with your life, and, you know, just don't settle. So, you know, I think I've settled long enough to make sure, you know, I've stacked up money to pay bills and things of that nature. It's my charge, I was actually commissioned for a couple other shows to paint people, mostly love animals. I was a child outside of, you know, artwork. I wanted to be a zoologist. And I found out how much the only time I was love people. So I figured I'd just paint the animals versus, you know, actually try to take care of them. I do a lot of work with young folks also, you know, try to inspire them to, you know, everybody's born artists. And a lot of people, you know, get told to stray away from. So, you know, I try to you know, instill in young folks that, hey, you may have a lot of people around you saying that you can and cannot do this, that, and the other. You know, if you love to paint, keep doing it. You know, if somebody else is saying, get a higher paying job, get a higher paying job, but still keep painting, still keep doing what you love to do, writing, what have you. Those are my motivations. Myself and helping out the young folks. Yes. Sometimes one of them, they come to me, and, you know, we have small little sessions, technique type deal to build up confidence. You know, people expect to, you know, be able to paint like this, just at the drop of a hat, and it's a lot of practice. But more than that, it's a lot of self-confidence. So, it's like a after-school type deal. I'm a five-year-old who just started school, so it's like a half a day, so everybody survives, sometimes come over, you know, we do that, and go out with my mom and dad, come home, something like that.
Oh, wonderful, what a gift. And your father taught you that way of teaching, huh?
Yes.
Yes, what could you tell us, what were some of the things you learned from your father?
Mostly technique. Of course, my father was a very busy man while I was growing up. I wasn't with him. I didn't see my folks too much. But, you know, when he was around, you know, he made sure that everything that I did was the absolute best of my ability, you know, no matter what it was. And, you know, don't get me wrong, you know, my folks were definitely in my life, and he was very busy. So it was more of a witnessing thing. So it was more of a leading by example. I'm not sure if anybody out here knows Bob Murphy. He's very entrepreneurial nowadays, trying to start up an all-male boarding school right now. He's been, you know, in and out of all types of buildings. So I'm sure you run across his path and understand the man, you know, without saying too much more as far as, you know, what he's still doing. His physical stature alone, and from, you know, his voice, and, you know, his presence. Yeah, mostly just the technique and keep pushing. Yes, ma'am.
Are you essentially self-taught?
I was wondering, are you essentially self-taught, or did you get classes or what?
I did. You know, I got advanced placement mark at my belt in high school. I was down at the University of Cincinnati studying graphic design, but I didn't pay too much attention. It's a lot of black lines. Yes, I am self-taught. I grew up copying out of comic books, you know, taking that style, redrawing it over and over and over again. It kind of bled over to now, you know, with the lines. And also, it helps to bring out the subject matter, the people, the animals that I'm painting.
Well,
Tom,
you caught such amazing soul-felt feeling
in
both of the women you painted.
I did my best. They're actually the first portraits I've ever painted in my life.
Oh.
As an adult, anyway, I did a lot when I was a child. But, yeah, you know, I was working on commercial stuff, so. Yeah, it was very, I was very nervous. But, you know, like I said, my father told me to, you know, to keep pushing through. sketches of finally figured out the eye placement and whatnot, let alone just picking the photographs of the ladies that I picked up from Martin Luther King. So many to choose from, so you know, I continue to feel like I'm, you know, reproduced to get that same, you know, flow that they gave in the photograph. Black line that we know pushing people out to you. A lot of people have a nice time running my veins to see if you know, say type of three-dimensionality to it. Which I don't mind about the touchments of why you want to code it, so you can do the damage to it.
Is that a sort of a signature, that feeling of going outside?
Yes.
Do you want to say that again for everybody?
I wondered if it was a signature of this page outside the borders.
Yeah. What do you think?
Yes. I never wanted to get into the fine art game looking like somebody else. So of course, you know, me and my love for animals, you know, I studied for about 6 months for all of my feet in the water. And I didn't find anybody that, you know, there are a lot of surrealists out there, you know, had a kind of cartoony, kind of realistic look, you know, the whole nine, but nobody was really messing with, you know, the block style of comic book art. Nobody else is doing it. It must be me. Hopefully start off a nice campaign of creativity.
So it feels like the background is abstract.
Yes.
And the foreground is black and white.
Yes.
Is that your style now?
No. Actually, that's, I'm colorblind, partially colorblind. I have a very hard time seeing the reds and greens. So, no, thank God for college and my father, a lot of years of color theory, you know, holding lots of color up to, you know, different swatches of, or, you know, dabs of paint. You know, I mix this and you say, hey, okay, well, this is actually a plum, it's not, you know, blue. I'm not saying, I think it's blue, but this is plum. And then, you know, just over and over and over and over and over again, finally able to kind of be okay. You know, I asked a lot of help, probably say about 6 or 7 people helped me perpaint it. Especially, you know, going to the art store or going shopping for clothing or anything like that, you know, I'm quite nervous. So, and, you know, just make sure my colors are correct, I asked. But outside of that, yeah, that was just to pay homage to the fact that I really can't see red and green, and red and green is.
Do you see any color when you see the red?
I do, but I have to stare at it for about 10, 15 minutes to differentiate between like a scarlet or a crimson, or even if I'm looking at red, it could be gray. So
it is red.
Yes, that's what everybody kept telling me.
So you have people help you pick out your paint?
Absolutely. Yeah, I do a lot of shopping down here at Dick Licks on Broad Street, and if I don't have somebody with me, I'm one of the people they were working to design, like, hey, you know, please. Although they're, you know, pretty good at asking as soon as you walk through the door, but yeah, I take that advice seriously.
Mark the paint?
Well, yeah, the words were on there for me, thank God, so. And also, there's a thing called a Pantone color sheet. It gives numbers that have never changed to specific colors. So, with the art store, you know, you kind of match up with their paint blocks to make sure that, you know, I do a lot of design before, you know, before I did the lady, Martin, do it through my computer after, you know, sketched it out and see where I wanted those colors. Okay, this color code says it's this. So, let me go to the store. Hey, lady, please help me. I'm trying to find this color code. And she helps me up and here we go. It's different, but. You know, I definitely think, I would like to think it makes my stuff unique. I have no idea how you guys see it, but to me, you know, that looks great. So, to me, so hopefully, you know, y'all sort of seeing the similar-ish thing that I'm seeing.
So
Yeah, I guess that's forest green, not dark grass and green, yes.
Well, Bettye, you're having known Tabu since he was born. You were the director when his father taught art. How does that feel to see this legacy continuing? Speaking of new birth and life,
I think it's wonderful. Oftentimes we don't think in terms of leaving a legacy, and I'm very much impressed with a number of legacies that I have seen in Columbus. As African Americans, we never thought about leaving a legacy. And as we look around the city, we can see with the wall on the cultural wall on Long Street, which certainly shows a deep legacy that people who lived and worked in the east side of Columbus have left. And so I'm always impressed with self-taught artists, or whether they're taught artists, that they begin to think about leaving a legacy. So when we look around at the art that's on the walls, we see that a number of the subject matter are people. And the thing that I see and understand now is that the artists of today are dealing with their environment. They're dealing with their particular time that is now, and of course that's the whether it's the internet or because I'm not really up on the internet like I should be, but we see as we look around the room there are different styles of art, and we have from where I'm sitting, I'm looking straight ahead and I see the jazzy tone. That's an artist that graduated from CCAD, and you can certainly see the influence of what the artist was doing. Next to that, we have a self-taught artist with the three women that she, in later life, has begun to paint. She's begun to paint. And so her work is interesting because she did look at Amina Robinson's work, and early on she had work that kind of illustrated some of the work that Amina was doing. I particularly like the work that's in the middle there, because it has all the faces, or many of the faces, during the Art of Renaissance. And then he has a little square that tells you who the people are, for those who may not know. I'm particularly impressed with the work by Regan on the Crisis and Josephine Baker. Is skillfully done. She also is a graduate from CCAD. But it's all pen and ink. And I think that it's just an incredible work of art. And then to the left of that, the artist is a... Her work is indicative of those artists who were in jazz, and that was a particular time in our life and in our period of time when jazz was very, very important. You have to excuse me. I'm not feeling well, and yeah, she has a number of divas, and this was during that period of time as well when dealing with the Harlem Renaissance. So she has the photographs there, and she has also some bios on the people that that are listed. And of course, this next to a piece that certainly came before us, wanted to pair a work of art by a new artist with a work by an older artist who was dealing with the slave time. So I thought that the two went together very well in terms of the color palette. So we can make that comparison.
When exactly was the Harlem Renaissance?
It was back in the 1920s, and that was when the artists came together and just to be together. You know, they came from different parts of the country, and many of them became very, very famous. And the thing today is that our young people do not know anything about the Harlem Renaissance. They don't know about that period of time when great artists came together, whether they were artists who were photographers, like James Van Der Cies, who was a great photographer, that many of the photographs that you see today certainly were taken by him. And of course, we have our own photographers here in the city. When you think of Kojo, who was a very prominent photographer, but he also studied about the Harlem Renaissance.
So
they're
kind of end and going into the 30s and 40s, or just kind of died away?
No, it went on for 100 years.
Oh,
100 years. That was a celebration in Columbus. Was I Choose Sing America, the Harlem Renaissance 100. So they celebrated the 100th year of what was happening in terms of African American art. Does that answer your question?
The exhibit at the Columbus Museum is wonderful. So great to see Elijah Pierce's work. I'm thinking of the day that I called Elijah Pierce, and I was sharing with Benny, was it 1983, 84, and invited him to a conversation, some coffee. And he just wasn't feeling right, so he wasn't able to do it. But when I see his work, all that time becomes timeless. And what a gift his leadership, what a gift your leadership is, Betty. Amazing. And you're part of this legacy, are you not there, Tyler?
I'm doing my best.
He really doesn't need a mic. But speaking of the Columbus Museum of Art, our own Will Haygood certainly was the person who was the curator of the works that was there in the museum. He traveled throughout the country, and he's quite a storyteller. I've known Will since he was a young man. I supervised him on the playground, so we connected in different ways as well. But it was a wonderful, wonderful program, and the museum also had other programs. They brought in Driscoll, who was a very important African-American historian that talked about his works during the Harlem Renaissance. And so the museum has certainly been on top of having wonderful exhibitions.
And Amina Robinson, I saw her work at the Hilton so beautiful behind the main desk. And I just said, oh, Amina's work. And the woman who was waiting on us, we stayed here for a fundraiser, this is a week ago, Saturday night, and she said, oh, you know Amina? I said, oh yes, I had her conversations and coffee. I'm thinking of a wonderful way to connect with artists that we have here in our conversation, in hers, in Elijah, so many. And her works are in the Hilton downtown. And someone has them all around, and it just brings such life to that place.
And I'd like to say that, you know, thanks to Barbara Nicholson, who was the former director at the King Arts Complex. She sits on the board at for the Convention Center, as well as the Hilton, you know, which is a part of it. It was in her inspiration that she wanted to have African American artists in the center to have original works, because when you look at hotels, you know, there's always the photographs that are either flowers or what have you. And if we're to become the city that we say that we are, then I think it's incumbent upon us to have good work. And so not only is the work of African Americans in the Hilton, but as well as in the Convention Center. And certainly Amina Robinson was a person that, probably not known her since she was a youngster, so to speak. And she worked for the Recreation and Parks Department at one time as well. And certainly celebrated many aspiring artists that have come along that are doing great things. Yes.
I love this quilt, Wild Women Don't Get the Blues. I also like the bumper sticker, Wild Women, or what is it, something like, Well-Tamed Women Never Are Famous. Well-Behaved Women Are Never Famous.
I think that's good too, right. She couldn't be here for our opening, but I'm certain that she will come back at another time, and perhaps when we have the next coffee and conversations, that she could be a person. The large pieces that are by an African artist, and I thought that they were so stunning. She just started painting.
Two weeks to a month, I don't have that.
as we come to closure, tell us what the children teach you.
They teach me a lot of patience. But not only that, they reaffirm to have a lack of fear. I try to do something every day that scares me or that puts me out of my place, something I'm not used to. You know, children, naturally, you know, most fears are taught. So, you know, I think I read a study that said that babies are afraid of two things, and that's things coming out really fast and loud noises. Outside of that, and my five-year-old is always saying, "Daddy, come on, spawn a roof." Sure, when it gets warm because there's snow there. She doesn't care. So, you know, stuff like that, you know, gives me a nice chuckle. You know, reminds me that, you know, the world isn't as serious as it appears to be. Although my oldest is 21. That's the story.
Are they autistic,
any of
your children?
All of them. I'm very proud to say. Doing my best to, you know, keep the legacy of artisticness growing. My oldest is a stylist. My 19-year-old is kind of bouncing back and forth between being a chef and a baker. It's down to my 5-year-old. She's turning into a musician. You know, but of course, you know, I'll let them choose whatever the heck they want to do. Just have them be there for it. But, you know, then I have real little beatings. I'm trying to get to talk.
And Bettye, you spent time, quite a bit of time, teaching children art.
Yes. as I said, some of my fondest years was working in recreation parks. 30 years working in different quadrants of the city. Certainly as a supervisor, supervising young people to go out and teach art, particularly on the playgrounds. And then, of course, when I went to the King Arts Complex, I developed all programs there, programs that are still in existence. Worked with many of the art, the first persons that worked with me were people that I got out of recreation parks. So I knew they knew me. They knew my standard of teaching, and I think that they certainly did a wonderful job. They were there for many years. And so, yes, teaching is very important, but not only did we teach the skills of the subject matter, but we were the parent. We were everything, you know, to that child. And so I get my rewards now when they come up to me and say, "I don't remember, I remember what you taught me. I didn't understand it then, but I understand it now that I have children." So what a great reward to have when they can say that to you.
Oh, and we thank you for your gift and your reward of Renaissance. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Because it is yesterday.